Hello everybody, this is the difference between nihilism and stoicism, the two completely different approaches. Obviously, we can start with nihilism and start with, this extreme pessimistic approach, as one might call. Obviously, it denies a lot of things, but it denies a greater meaning to the things we experience in life. Obviously, stoicism is just the opposite, a positive attempt to find the most meaningful, in accordance with our nature, way to live. The point where two get confused is the Stoic idea of indifference. Unlike the nihilists who deny that a particular thing is good or bad, Stoics question the usual standard by which most people judge what is good or bad, and hold that the things outside our control are neither good nor bad. Therefore, they are different because they have no moral value. Health, wealth, reputation, social order, the way you're in social class, whatever, and are ultimately different things in Stoicism because they don't qualify as being good. But Stoic students do recognize that it's preferable to be healthy, wealthy, and well thought of. Obviously, we could talk about cynicism, which is derived from Diogenes and his approach to life. I mean, his approach to life was completely different to the Stoics. He didn't like to be qualified as a philosopher, which interested Alexander the Great, which even he visited him, and he wasn't very happy about him. He said, "Why are you standing in my sunlight?" So along those lines, I'm not really quoting exactly what he said. I'm just saying that he just didn't really like to be bothered. He wanted to live his own life according to himself. And he was kind of the most anti-philosopher out there. But he still explained as a philosopher. But that's where I think many philosophical ideas have arranged in different kind of meaning. We obviously had existentialism or Søren Kierkegaard, which then became really nihilism, really, if we think about it. But obviously there's one Stoic quote that I love. I mean, this is a quote that I think most people will not necessarily agree, but I think it's a good quote. It's by Seneca, and he said, "But life is very short and anxious for those who forget the past, neglect the present, and fear the future." If we go back to the nihilist approach, we wouldn't have, you know, someone like Friedrich Nietzsche who would agree with this statement. He would probably say that everything in the world displeases me, but above all, my displeases and everything displeases me. You know, but obviously, to live is to suffer, to survive is to find some meaning in the suffering. He would obviously have different ways to view it, but he did obviously take some credit off the Stoic idea, including amorphati, which is a very, very Stoic idea, but he hated the concept. He also didn't really like the concept of nihilism. He didn't really want it to be associated with one specific approach, really. But the whole view of Stoicism and nihilism is very taken upon today. Like, a lot of people who really want to transition to a better person, or a person who can be more positive in life, will take the Stoic attitude, will take the negative approach, maybe like more like a Squidward approach, will take the nihilistic approach. But both views should be taken into consideration. Like, I mean, most of what we have is completely divided into views and approaches. Many people don't approach this person's view and don't approach another person's view, which, I mean, it's completely understandable if the view is threatening someone or something, then the view should not be taken seriously. But if the view adds something to the debate, let's say if it tries to debate something, I would say we should not disvalue what the person is trying to say. But that's not the point of emphasis here. Point of emphasis we're talking about is Stoicism, nihilism. But I'm also including we have a lot of other different issues, and not necessarily in the world, but altogether. And but it's just it we can come back to here, and we can talk about how the differences is between the world and us and everything, you know. But obviously we have different Stoic ideas. Epicureanism, which is doctrine of life of withdrawal in contemplation and escape of worldly affairs, and it's believed that pleasure, as the absence of pain, is the goal of humans. But the Stoic approach really dates back to early Greek Stoicism and ancient Stoicism, and even some pre-Socratic Stoicism, like Zeno, which we have not really known his own writing. We only known his writing because of others. Stoics who applied to what his framework of Stoic philosophy was. But I felt we Zeno, he kind of approached it, and he kind of influenced Chrysippus, a lot different, a lot more philosophers out there. This view kind of changed the way we live and the way we think, I think, because we're still using it today. I mean, this was written thousands of years ago, I mean. But then we had later Roman Stoicism, obviously, with Cicero, and there was a lot of Roman Stoicism was very influenced by Plato and Aristotle, which brought a new kind of teaching, and the kind of, I think it spread, the teaching spread more and more as time went on, and now it spreads to all types. Like, look at Western philosophy, and Taoism and Buddhism, or let's take it more of a philosophical idea rather than the religious idea, it spread it across to Western, now Western civilization. I think Alan Watts did more influencing than we known. Obviously, he was influenced by Krishnamurti, but he kind of brought that idea of Buddhism and of Western philosophy across to us. I recommend listening to Alan Watts if you are interested in a more Stoic based, we're more closer to what Stoics believe. I think many people should actually consider listening to him. Many people will not be open-minded to it, but I would consider it. It could actually help you into the future and change actually your own life. But let's go on and talk about a lot of nihilistic philosophers out there, because there's a lot. Like, my probably my favorite one is probably Emile Cioran. Surprisingly, Emile Cioran, whose idea was kind of a very different philosopher. Especially, I don't think many people really, at the time when he was living, I don't think many people really, they thought him of more of a failure. But he was much, much more than that. He was quite pessimistic. And he was pretty God-fearing man. He was a God-fearing man, realizing how blasphemous its contents were. Well, his way where he wrote, he refused to touch it. But Emile Cioran, he was a Romanian-born philosopher, which he then moved to France. And his writing style is very whimsical. It's very not really systematic. Almost like how I'm talking. It's very. He called it himself, actually, un homme de fragment. That's how he called it. Cioran often contradicts himself, almost like I do. I'm not trying to compare myself to him, but he does contradict himself. But that's not the least of his worries. With him, self-contradiction is not even the weakness, but the sign a mind is alive. For writing, he believed it's not about being consistent, nor about persuasion or keeping our readership entertained. Writing is not even about literature for Cioran. Just like Montaigne, Michel de Montaigne, several centuries earlier, writing has the distinctive performative function. You write not to produce some body of text, but to act upon yourself, to bring yourself together after a personal disaster, or to pull yourself out of a bad depression, to come to terms with a deadly disease, or to mourn the loss of a close friend. You write not to go mad, not to kill yourself or others. In a conversation with Spanish philosopher Fernando Savater, I like his name, Cioran says at one point, "If I didn't write, I could have become an assassin." Very ironic, I would say. He was said here. I would say it's very ironic. Writing is a matter of life and death. Human existence, as its core, is an endless anguish and despair. And writing can make things a bit more bearable. A book, said Cioran, is a suicide postponed. And I do agree with to what he has to say here. I do believe that keeping yourself entertained on some kind of concept or some kind of abstract thing one might do, I think that one may keep his interests and interests of life and routine pain more together than just doing nothing and waiting pretty much to death just to come around, you know, being just a complete, you know, that song by Syd Barrett, The Scarecrow, just completely waiting life to disintegrate you and to just to pretty much be standing there and waiting for nothing to arise. And though nihilism is very frowned upon nowadays, I think there's more and more nihilists nowadays, but I say that nihilism by chance isn't a thing that gets propagated to the mainstream just because of its extreme pessimistic idea. And I think there was Clive Barker, there was this poem after a battle lasting many ages, I'm going to tell it right now. The devil won and said to God, who had been his maker, "Lord, we are about to witness the unmaking of a creation. By my hand, I would not wish you to think me cruel. So I beg you, take three things from this world before I destroy it. Three things, and then the rest will be whipped away." Or wiped away. Not whipped away. Why did I say whipped? A good God taught for a little time, and at last he said, "No, there is nothing." The devil was surprised. "Not even you, Lord?" he said. And God said, "No, not even me." That's a very interesting way. Many would say this is very sad and pretty much nihilistic. And obviously maybe of loss as well. But I feel like that's what nihilism tries to portray here.
I think we're gonna just wrap it up here quickly.